Hey guys, you're watching the Best Practices Show, where we take a look at the best business practices from the best dental practices all across the country. And I know you're working to get better on how you do dentistry. And today we're going to be talking about making huge progress in the digital contemporary practice. And I've got one of the world's experts, Dr. Paresh Shah, with me today. You're going to love this. So do me a favor, grab a pen and hit the share button. We'll see you in a second. The Best Practices Show. We're so excited you guys are on. This has been so much fun, and we've got people giving us feedback from all over the world on things that they want to see, and today is one of those things that you truly want to see. Just a couple show notes before we get started. We are shooting this live on Facebook, so as you have questions that come up during the broadcast, please ask the questions, and I'll ask my good friend Paresh to answer the questions directly, or if you're watching this later on, because we do see the metrics, people are watching this, you know, late at night or whatever, ask the question, and we want to make sure we get you the right answer. We love the questions so much that we're doing what's called Gratitude Monday. So the questions have been incredibly thoughtful this week, like really good and tough questions. And I'm giving away a free Apple iWatch every Monday just to the best question asked, along with two free tickets to Activate. So check it out and please ask great questions. Today's a special episode because I've got one of my good friends on, and we've gone through this journey together and grown together. We met at the Seattle Study Club Symposium years ago, and I've watched, you know, you, Paresh, just completely explode on the scene, and now you're doing digital smile design and all these things. And being a young dentist or even a mature dentist and embracing technology and all these thoughts that come into your brain, it's important to sort this out so that you enjoy the way you practice. And I want to say just a couple things about my friend Paresh is that, you know, as a speaker and somebody who's out there as a thought leader in dentistry, I really love the way you think. You know, you and I are very much on the same page that as you get better or get even a little bit more mature, you have to start picking and choosing the things that you really, really enjoy. And we're going to talk about your journey that happened about 2 years ago. But for those people that don't know who Paresh Shah is, who is Dr. Paresh Shah?
Well, you know, I practice general dentistry in Winnipeg, Canada. I've been here almost my whole life. Born in India, moved here when I was about 2.5 years old. My family moved. My dad came to do a residency here in obstetrics, and it's home. And so I've done all my education here. I practiced for 25 years as a solo practitioner. I've had some associates along the way. And I love what I do. Got a great family. My wife is a business leader here. She's in corporate finance. And our daughter, Serena, graduates from dental school, the University of Pacific, San Francisco, in 2 months. So it's pretty exciting. So we got that's basically our life in a nutshell. It's busy. It's fun. It's exciting. And I love what I do. I love practicing dentistry. And I love teaching and educating people and sharing my successes and my failures so people can learn from that.
Yeah. And I want you to go through kind of your journey. You know, like I said, you and I have been blessed with the opportunity to be heavily involved with the Seattle Study Club. Dr. Michael Cohen has completely transformed both of our lives because not only being in the education part, but the relationship side, the interdisciplinary side, it's a whole new world of just the way to see things. And so take us through your journey, because 8 years ago you were kind of doing digital, got involved with it, and then 2 years ago you made a very firm decision that was a big decision for you. What was that decision?
Yeah. You know, for me, it was one of those things where I'm, you know, for the longest time I'm sitting around loving how I'm practicing. I mean, just kind of doing dentistry, successful practice. But I always, you know, reaching for that carrot. And I think a lot of people will be doing that, especially, you know, at my age and part in my career, where you want to be able to practice the dentistry that you're, you know, drives you and gives you the passion, right? And I wasn't quite doing that. I mean, I'd come in, I'd finish taking courses, or you go on a vacation, you come back, and the treadmill's running real fast, and you just kind of hop on it, and you have good intentions, but you just continue on, and it's like, oh my God, it's still the same thing. And I kind of said, you know what, I really want to practice like this for the last maybe quarter of my career. And I said, I want to be as contemporary as possible. I've been practicing interdisciplinary care, a comprehensive diagnosis and treatment planning, but I wanted to go more digital. And so I just kind of cut the cord and I told my team, okay, this is it. Like starting January, we're going to go digital, which meaning we're getting rid of impression material. We're getting rid of all this stuff. And we're going to really do this. And they're kind of looking at me going, okay, you sure about this? And I go, yeah. And I said, believe me, but once we get to that point, we're going to also be, we're not going to compromise the philosophy of the practice about comprehensive care, because we're going to incorporate all of that within this digital workflow. Mm-hmm. So still do proper diagnosis and treatment planning and treatment rendering in a comprehensive manner. And then I'm going to work on my specialists and we're going to get them on board. And that's kind of, it's been a fun, interesting journey. I wouldn't have been able to do it without, you know, people like organizations like the Seattle Study Club and, you know, people that I've learned from the COI Center and all these other things. So,
yeah, absolutely. You've got a world of education underneath your belt that has come to the perfect culmination of what you're doing right now. Now, I want you to talk about this because I love you and I've had conversations about this is when we talk about multidisciplinary and interdisciplinary, those are not the same things. And you lit that up for me and kind of, go ahead.
Yeah. And you know my buddy Tim Dumore, right? The orthodontist.
Yeah.
Right. So this was probably, I don't know, probably at least 12, 13 years ago. He hands me this book by Rick Roble, who's one of our mentors and friends from Arkansas orthodontist. And it's called Comprehensive Interdisciplinary or Dentofacial Therapy. And he goes, just read this book because this is how we're going to practice. I'm like, okay. So I'm reading this book and it talks about, and Rick breaks things down and differentiates between unidisciplinary, multidisciplinary, and interdisciplinary. And the bottom line is, you know, we use the term in medicine and dentistry, multidisciplinary, very freely. There's a difference between having a multidisciplinary practice and having an interdisciplinary. Multidisciplinary is like, really quickly, just, hey, I'm aware that there are other disciplines. I'm just going to send my patient off to get ortho and oral surgery and implants put in. No communication. Oral surgeon and periodontist or oral surgeon and the orthodontist, they don't even communicate with each other. It's just patient goes, gets the ortho done, space open, or prosthetic space open, they get an implant stuck in there in the wrong spot, and then they come back and dentist doesn't know and they stick it in and the patient's all unhappy. Right. Well, it's because we know everyone has their strengths, but no one's talked to each other. Mm-hmm. Interdisciplinary meanings, I send, as a restorative dentist, I send the patient to the specialist. We already have discussed goals that the patient wants. Now we look at the strengths and we sit down with the surgeon and go, can you do this? I go, yeah, I can do this, but the roots are like this. Like, I need an orthodontist to move the teeth in the right spot so I have space to put it in the right spot so I can get the crown the way you want it. Mm-hmm. Okay, so let's talk with one another. Interdisciplinary. We're communicating and we're following the patient through. Huge difference.
Yeah.
And most people just go, you know what? I don't want to deal with the ortho. Just I'm sending them off. They come back and then the teeth aren't in the right spot or the gums are all over the place. And next thing you know, you have to talk about crown lengthening. You have to talk about cutting down healthy teeth that they didn't expect to cut down because just that 15-minute conversation with one another to guide the teeth in the right spot or guide the space in the right spot or to take a CT scan to get the implant in the right spot wasn't taken.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
It's not one person's fault. It's everyone's fault.
Right. Right. You know, and the question I have for you, because you've done a lot of thought on this, is that, you know, how much of number one does failure play a role in this for you to be able to say, hey, look, I'm not going to do this anymore the way I'm doing it. You know, symposium, they did the failures symposium, done them twice. And now that's powerful because you learn so much from failure. And then the second piece, if I'm a young dentist watching this, you know, who may be 32 years old, how much does self-awareness play in the role? Because you and I both know the older you get, the more you learn about yourself and you go, look, I'm, because you tried to be the best ortho, you tried to do all that, didn't you? Because you went through Mish, you went through COIS, right. You came back and you tried to do it all. And you were like, I don't know that I'm the best at all this.
No,
right?
No, I did. I've done ortho courses in the past. It's really funny. I took these ortho courses like years ago, continuum for weekends. And my two close friends are orthodontists and they never said a word. I still referred stuff. And afterwards, they both eventually bailed me out of two cases. And I go to them and I'm like, oh my God, like you're like two parents. You just let your kid kind of walk out there, fall on right. their face. And then you invited us back home and they go, yeah, we knew that would happen. And yeah. It's one of those things where, yeah, you have to, you know, one of the biggest things is you have to be humble. Mm-hmm. You really do have to be humble and at least, but confident. There's right. a confidence there too, but you have to also, like the first thing you got to do is be able to look in the mirror and go, look, am I doing the best service for the patients? And two, am I enjoying it? And you get to the point after a while, it's like, geez, you know, I can do better. But the failures thing's important. When I do my lectures, I share a lot of stuff that I have done. It's not just stuff that I've seen from other dentists or specialists that have gone wrong. I show a lot of stuff that I could have done better. And I'll put it up and I'll go, what's wrong with this? And they'll look and they'll say it. I go, yeah, that was me. Mm-hmm. That was super dentist back then. And I said, you know, what could we have done differently? What do we know now?
Yeah.
What are our strengths? And so, yeah, the failures have been a huge thing, yeah. but you got to also, be able to at least look in the mirror and go, look, I'm not doing the patient any surgery. Why do I not do root canals anymore?
Right.
I'm not good at it. And I don't enjoy it. Right. I just don't enjoy them.
Right. So. Now, I want to say this too, because I don't want to ever sound like, well, there's so much dogma around this. You know, the coolest part about practicing in North America or any place in dentistry is you can choose. You know, you can choose if you want to do everything, you can.
Right.
And then you can choose to specialize. I know myself well enough. I just don't do things. I don't do everything well. I only do a few things well, you know. And I think the important thing is if you're watching this, don't lie to yourself, whatever it is, because sometimes we get convinced to do things because we heard an article or we read an article, went to a lecture. The cool part is that if you educate yourself well enough, like you did, you can say, hey, look, I know how I want to practice. And 2 years ago, you made that decision, you know, to embrace, you know, the contemporary digital practice.
Right.
And you had to get your team involved. And you mentioned that's a huge piece. So how did you do that?
Okay. That is one of the biggest things. You want to progress. You've got to have mentors. You've got to have a really good core of specialists that you work with that work collaboratively, and then you've got to get your team completely on board. And I think that was probably the largest challenge, is bringing them up to a level where they understand what comprehensive dentistry is about. Why we want to educate our patients and treat our patients that way and not just a symptom. Don't get me wrong. I mean, a person's in pain or breaks a tooth, you got to fix it. But it's more than just that. You want to help them with everything. But how do you get that team involved? How do you get them trained? How do you get them believing? And how do you empower them to want to do that and also be accountable for what they're doing? And the big thing with that is, I needed to get external help to get them trained on certain things. Mm-hmm. I just don't have the physical time. And I think a lot of dentists, that's their biggest challenge, is like, oh my God, like how do I get my team involved in understanding what I'm learning? Because some of these programs, we can't bring them to, we can bring them to a big meeting. Mm-hmm. But I would love to have a situation where the COIS Center had like maybe the ability to bring your team for a whole weekend to understand everything, right? So how do you get them involved in that? Some of the other training centers around the actually do have that. I believe Spear does have now something related to the team. I'm not sure about Pankey and Dawson, but, you know, Seattle Study Club, like they, you know, sometimes you can bring some team members. It'd be nice if you could bring the entire and then have a track with just where you can bring your entire team. Okay. Yeah. They started that 2 years ago as you was there with the business side of it. Right.
Yeah.
So I had to bring in a variety of different trainers/coaches to come in. And I sat down with the people and I said, okay, for this year, this is what I want to accomplish with my hygienists. This is what I want to accomplish with my business team. This is what I want to accomplish specifically with my dental assistants. Can you get this message to them? Are you comfortable teaching these things? Because this is the philosophy, and I give them some information on it.
Yeah.
That's how I did it. Yeah. And I then backed off and let them teach that.
Right.
If they swayed, I went back in. I go, no, this is not what I'm looking for. This is what I'm looking for. Very particular about that. But that made a difference.
Yeah.
Then you got to keep bringing it back. So that's been a huge part of it. They have to buy into the philosophy, and then you got to let them run with it.
Yeah.
Micromanaging is my middle name, and I'm trying extremely hard. And I think if you ask my team over the last 2 years, I'm better at it. I'm not great at it, but I'm a lot better at it in the last 2 years.
I'm a recovering micromanager. Now I love this because the integration part. Now you even with your hygienist, what you did with your hygienist and your periodontist, you didn't make them exclusive of each other. You said, hey, look, if we're going to do this, we're going to get calibrated. So your hygienist went through training with your periodontist. Is that how you did that?
Not exactly that way, but what we've done over the past while, I've also had some periodontists come in periodically to work in the practice, which I'm kind of moving away from that now. But the thing is, you know, one of the issues is you'll have, you know, as a general dentist running a business, you start worrying about the fact that, hey, you send off a patient to perio, and the big fear that a lot of GPs have is, oh, all of a sudden they're not going to come back because they're going to see the periodontist on a regular basis. Periodontist, most of the time, I'm hoping they would at least say, hey, you need a restorative exam at least once or twice a year.
Right.
But some of them don't say that. Some of the patients don't see the value in it. And so you don't see them, and all of a sudden they're gone. And then they come back when there's some big problem and we're the bad guy. Mm-hmm. So what, and the other issue is you send off to a periodontist, and all of a sudden they need more, like they're an advanced perio case, and all of a sudden they've got to go through all of this active therapy to get them stable before they can start doing surgery or implants or anything else.
Right.
And insurance is all used up. Mm-hmm. So they're sitting in our practice, and they're, you know, we're using up insurance by scraping teeth.
Right.
I'm using that term, scraping teeth, not treating them necessarily, but just scraping teeth. And then we send them off, and then more scraping, and the insurance is used up, and the patient's upset. Like, I can't do my surgery because my insurance is blown.
Right. Okay?
And it's like, okay, so how do we fix that? How do we do that transition? How do we work collaboratively? Well, why don't we find out what is the periodontist that we work with? What are the periodontists that we work with? What are they looking for? And how do we build trust that, hey, within my practice, my team knows what they're doing, and they're calibrated enough that when we transfer, that they don't have to redo everything.
Right.
So you sit down and go, well, what records do you do? How do you measure appointment to appointment? What do you do? And it's like going back to school.
Right.
Well, you do all the records. You don't just measure pockets or do a PSR. You do the whole thing. Pocketing, mobility, furcation, bleeding, and give a diagnosis, a periodontal diagnosis for that patient. So now once you have a diagnosis, and maybe you look at the perio risk assessment that John Coyce has, and the girls can understand that because it's in color. It's green, yellow, red. And you look at the categories, it's a case type 3, it's yellow. Well, these are the therapies we have. This is the frequency that the literature shows that if we bring you in at that and do some of these therapies, that we can maintain you.
Yeah.
So that's where the coach comes in to train them on those things. But now with the periodontist, now let's say we've got a person that we're just not helping and there's a problem. Now it's easy because my three hygienists, and I have three full-time hygienists, it's a busy practice.
Mm-hmm.
They'll go, I'll already walk in the room. They'll go, you know what? I've already told them that we're having some trouble here and we haven't seen improvement for the last 6 to 12 months. And they know that you're going to probably say, we've got to go see the periodontist.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have to do that anymore. I go, absolutely. Let's verify. Let's troubleshoot. Now, when I send off the periodontist, they will always redo your measurements.
Yeah.
That they have to do that.
Yeah.
But I'm going to tell you right now, in the last 3-4 years, the number of times that we've been off and I've had a call and go, I don't know what your measurements are, but you're way off, 2 times.
Yeah.
My team is on board. They respect what we're doing. So now when they go in, they're automatically, after their initial consult, going in and planning their surgery or their therapy.
Yeah.
They're not redoing the last 6 months.
Yeah.
And then they send back and go, okay, go that through maintenance. And then I'll go, hey, do you want to share the, you know, continuing care for the next year just to make sure? Yeah, let's do that. And then our teams will coordinate that and go, okay, you know, 3 months with me, 3 months with them. I don't get, you know, it's about the patient. But the thing is, we built that trust. And my hygienists are not tooth scrapers.
Yeah.
They are healthcare professionals. When the patients come in and they take a bleeding score, there's no word of a lie. The patient will go, what's my score? Mm-hmm. Like, is it over 20 again? Do I have to, you know, like they're asking those questions.
Yeah, this is awesome. Now, I'm going to play devil's advocate because I love what you're saying. But let's say I'm a young dentist and I've got two hygienists. You've got three. Paresh, really easy to say, but how do I get all these people calibrated? Because I've told them over and over again. And one of the mutual books that you and I love so much, Coyce made me read it. I don't know if he made, but the Checklist Manifesto. And I've seen yours. I mean, your checklists are phenomenal. How important is that to the contemporary digital practice workflow? I mean, that's got to be one of the cornerstones, because you as a clinician are going to decide what your standard of care is, and you've got to be able to transfer that consistently through three hygienists.
That's he made me read it as well. And he didn't made me, but he strongly encourages certain books. And it's like, if you don't read it, you miss out, right? So read it years ago, and it's like, darn, like, it was funny because I did that, and within a month, I'm on an airplane flying to a study club from Toronto to Rochester. I was the only one on the plane. Two pilots, two other pilots that were going to deadhead in Rochester, so they had to fly the plane. Mm-hmm. And I'm sitting in the first row, obviously, and the two pilots are going through their checklist, even with me, just one passenger. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, oh, my God. See the importance of it?
Right.
And so I incorporated that. It creates accountability and it allows training. Right. So my team, I mean, for the longest time, they rolled their eyes and they're like, oh my God, checklist again. But I say, you know what? Here's the thing. Like Atul Gawande talks about, it's like we're in an era right now where there is so much information to process. We can't remember it all. So why do it? I tell my team, why are you going to stress when you come in the morning that, hey, did I put the toilet paper in the patient washroom? Should you be thinking about that when you come in? No. You should be thinking about, okay, I just want to get in that frame of mind for my patient, for my team, and just get going for our team meeting and start treating them. On the checklist, it'll say, oh, I forgot to put the toilet paper in there and I forgot to get hand sanitizer in my room. Let me go and grab it. You should not stressing about that.
Right.
And that's what it's about. And so I went to my assistant, Lara, about a month ago, and I said, Lara, let me ask you something. I noticed you sometimes change the checklist. How do you do that? Why? And he goes, because we're noticing you're working on a procedure. Next thing you know, it's different from what we've been doing for the last couple of months. So Jazz and I will sit down and go, we got to change our checklist.
Right.
And you just do it? And she goes, yeah, we just do it. And then we laminate it. They laminate the checklist. And so you can actually put cross marks on there.
So you have a laminated one in each one of the ops for each patient? How do you do that?
No. Okay. We've got one that's laminated for just our basic procedure. But if there's, let's say there's a restorative procedure, they've got a checklist for that. If it's an extraction, they've got a checklist. If it's for perio, they've got theirs, and it'll have a checklist. Is this perio maintenance? Is this a comprehensive exam? Is this an annual perio maintenance? Is this a recare exam? And they check that off, and then they've got a checklist. There's a section on x-rays. There's a section on clinical findings. There's a section, and it's just to jog their memory.
Right.
When they look at it, it's not on a tray cover. I walk in. If I walk in a spot where I'm not, you know, I'm walking in, our rooms are all different. One time I walk from the side, one I walk behind, one I walk in front. I just want to glance over at it and look at anything. If it's a highlighted thing, med history, it's a jog on their memory to not forget, hey, I need to take a perio measurement. I need to take an x-ray.
Right.
It's for them. And if there's a key finding, they just put it in there. And I'll look at it and go, hey, Mary, I noticed that, you know, Jenny just told, you know, was talking to you about a broken tooth over here. Let me take a look at it.
Yeah.
How did you know? And I go, well, She already told me that. And it's just, then we do that thing about how you guys try and teach is about talking over with the patient and things like that. But the checklists have been huge. So I get them to modify that all the time to right. suit their needs and their training style. Someone likes to maybe read from top to bottom. Another person might like to look at collections because they're more of an intuitive rather than a sensor, right? Put the checklist the way you want, but just put the information you need to get it done. When you check a patient out, don't forget what box to check off on the computer form so that the payment goes to the patient if they're paying us directly. Like, just do those little details.
Right.
That's what you do. So each one probably has at least 6 to 8 checklists, and they change them as they need it.
That's awesome. And I like what you said.
Accountability.
It's accountability.
If you walk in the room and all of a sudden that burr is missing in the middle of a procedure, I don't like that.
Right.
They know that. And we'll look over and then they walk out and then we make eye contact and they go, my bad.
Yeah.
There's nothing else to be said.
Because when the burr's missing, that's when that vein comes out in the side of your neck like this.
Absolutely.
You know, and I like what you said though, because really the checklist, it's accountability, it's consistency. But the other thing is it frees up bandwidth up here. Like, you don't think about what you're doing. I was in Jimmy John's the other day picking up a platter of sandwiches, and this kid was filling out a check. I go, what is that? He goes, it's my checklist. I have to fill out and make sure that the checklist last night was actually done, and I have to do this 3 times a day or lose my job. I'm like, really? Now, you could say, well, that's Jimmy John's, but the fact is they don't have to think about anything. And Paresh, in your practice, you've got, you know, sometimes hundreds of patients that are going through this whole contemporary digital practice workflow, which we're going to talk about in a second. You have to have consistency at an extremely high level, and I don't know how you would do it without a checklist.
Right. And so that's been a huge part of it, and it has worked. They're really awesome. Is it perfect? No. But are we really at a much higher efficient level and more cohesive? 100%. You know, sometimes I do have to go back and remind them, hey guys, like the last 2 days, people have been off, so it's pretty obvious we're not on point. So I want all of them like completely out, and I just want to see them. I want to see the check marks, and then they'll go through it. Yeah, we'll do it. And it just, you get kind of recalibrates and get back on track.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Now, when we're talking about making the progress in a contemporary digital practice, one of the things that you've done is that when you're purely digital, you have the ability to see everything in real time. Can you talk about that? Because, you know, you worry about what's going to be happening. You know, Tim, your orthodontist is spectacular, but all this is in real time. So there's not a whole lot of calling and checking in. I mean, it's all there right in front of you, and you can see everybody's hands on. Is that true as far as how you do it?
Well, you know what? I guess there's a couple of things. One is, how do you incorporate it and get the team involved and just getting the workflow within the practice? And then the other is the interdisciplinary and the collaborative part, which I think you might be referring to, is like, how do the communication and can you still practice comprehensive interdisciplinary care in a digital practice? And is it easier or more challenging? I would suggest that it is easier. The challenges are more getting people into digital.
Right.
But once you're into it, the communication, in my opinion, is more fluid and easier and more convenient.
Right.
Never mind the predictability of digital. For instance, for the longest time, Tim in his practice, he has an orthodontic practice that's been digital even longer than my practice. So there'd be times where I'd say, hey, I want to discuss this case. And he'd send me this digital 3D models that I'd look on my screen and I'd be like, cool, but you know, can you print it for me? Can I mount it? Can I do my normal thing? And it's like, yeah, we could get it printed. And so now we're at the point where through a lot of the digital smile design, just very simplified protocols that Christian Coachman's developed that we're working with Orem Labs and Seattle Study Club. And we can actually just with videos and small, like just very simple digital SLR or iPhone photos and a digital intraoral scan, right, that we can put this information together and now share that information amongst our specialists through a secure portal, not through email, but actually there are secure HIPAA compliant portals that we can use and actually share this information. So now I can take, if we're trying to treatment plan a case comprehensively, I don't have to physically be in the same room with the orthodontist and the surgeon and the periodontist or whoever the specialist were with, the endodontist, and do that. We can share that information. We can get up onto our computers like you and I are doing right now from two different cities, two different countries, and we can actually diagnose and treatment plan.
Yeah.
And can we add a cone beam in there? Of course you can. There's software that allows us to look at all three. So we can look at a smile design. We can look at the patient's digital scans, like true real life 3D scans. We can look at their photographs and actually superimpose the photographs with their scan and with the cone beam. I mean, we're treatment planning from our own room. Now, that makes it easier because I'm, you know, in the past, I'd be trying to get together with these specialists and go, okay, well, can we do it? Well, I got to take Johnny to baseball, so I may not be free till 9:30 at night. And someone else is like, well, I'm traveling. I got a flight. I can't do that. And now we can.
Right.
And Winnipeg's easy to travel around compared to other cities. But, I mean, you're in St. Louis. When you get into rush hour traffic or you're in Los Angeles rush hour traffic, you might not get home on time.
Yeah. Although I did fly into Winnipeg that one night and it was like minus 29. But everybody's got their you know, things. Now, I want to talk about this too, because you and Christian, you know, when you guys talk about the digital practice, you use the word workflow. Some people might not know what a workflow is. What's a digital workflow?
Well, here's the thing. It's incorporating all the pieces to make your practice digital. And so it starts from, you know, I mean, it doesn't necessarily have to pertain just to scanning, but all the components that are digital. Like you can start with your diagnostics and, you know, digital radiographs. I mean, look, you've gone to probably more practices than I have, because most of the time when I'm educating and teaching, it's in lectures and study clubs, not physically going to people's offices, which, you know, so when you go there, I'm sure you have clients, and you don't have to mention names, that they're still using the regular analog x-rays.
Oh, yeah.
How to diagnose from a 2-inch x-ray? I can't even see them now at my age. You know, I need these progressives.
Oh, yeah.
But, right? So it's one of those things where, you know, incorporating just basic fundamental diagnostic tools, like, you know, digital radiography. If you can afford a cone beam, which I don't have that in my structure in my practice, but I've got one 10 minutes away. So it's easy to, you know, at a friend's office, using some of the diagnostic tools that carries like CareView and other things like that, those kind of tools to help you with the diagnosis, engaging the patients, then bringing in intraoral scanning. And that is a huge part. Patients, what better way to now engage the patient than to actually show them a 3D scan of their mouth right there during your exam.
Yeah.
I'll tell you what I do right now.
Yeah.
As of January 3rd, all three of my hygienists scan every new patient and every existing patient comprehensive exam. Every one of them.
Okay.
We're not at the point where we scanned every patient because that takes time, but every one of them do that. Mm-hmm. And why? Because it's part of our comprehensive exam. When they come in, they've got not only some digital SLR photos, and part of it is to help me with the patient with educating them with photographs, and part of it is also to help me with some of my lectures if it's a cool case.
Yeah.
So it's kind of a combined thing with permission from the patients, of course. But we've got our photographs, we've got our digital scan, we've got a periodontal chart, we've got our radiographs. Now that digital scan takes us to another level.
Mm-hmm.
Because now they see the 3D scan. I can walk up to the screen and I can spin that at 360 degrees. I can zoom in on it. They can look at crazy stuff on there that you would never be able to see anywhere. You know what I'm talking about? They can see the bite and go, you know, off the x-ray, they'll see a tooth tipped and go, you know, we need to upright it and then we can put a molar here or we do a bridge. And now they're looking at it in 3D and they're going, oh, I see what you mean. Like, that's really tipped.
Yeah.
Because I didn't fill that space. Like, 15 years ago, I go, yeah,
right. Yeah.
And they see it in 3D and in color. Oh my God. So how do you get that workflow? You start with your team. You get them comfortable. You get them understanding that this is part of the new electronic health record for all our patients.
Right.
Is everything together. Now you take that workflow and now all these these companies are starting to open up their platforms into what we call an open STL format. Now, most of the companies are starting to do that. Sirona just announced that last month at the IDS. Now they're going to do it. And that was one of the last holdouts. Mm-hmm. And so it's one of these things where all the companies are going to start doing that. So pretty soon, whatever scanner you get, you're going to be able to take that information. And pretty soon, you're going to be able to use almost any lab. Right. You can use a mill in your practice if you want. You can use a model. I have a model printer as well. Got right. a mill. I've got all that stuff. So yeah, I need a diagnostic record. I can print it or I can send it off to my lab. I can send the digital file there. I send it to the lab. The lab now will open up the file. And I mean, even if they're in another city, they'll receive it in real time, like within a few minutes, mm-hmm. possibly. And when they get it, they can open it up and maybe finish the restoration that day and ship it out that night. And you might get it the day after.
Yeah.
That's a digital workflow. So there's a digital workflow for diagnosing, for engaging the patient, for creating an electronic health record. There's a digital workflow for being able to take that information and communicate with your specialists and your patients and communicating with your lab.
Yeah.
And then you can generate these things. What does digital smile design do? Stop me if I'm rambling, Kirk.
No, you're good.
But what does digital smile design do? Now it brings the patient involved in it. Because what we're doing is our conventional mock-ups that we've been doing for years where, you know, Kirk, you want to change your smile. Okay, well, here, what are you thinking about? And you go, well, here's a picture of so-and-so, and I'd love this. And so I'll maybe send a picture or two to the lab. I'll tell, and we'll take an impression. They'll put some wax on there. The wax is going onto a plaster cast with no teeth on there, with no lips on there. They don't know. They maybe look at a picture. Maybe if you're progressive from back then, like 10 years ago, you might have sent a video, but most of us didn't.
Right.
And so the lab's just kind of doing it. And then you bring it in, you take a mold and you stick it in the patient's mouth, or you do a wax up in the mouth or a mock up in the mouth, and you kind of get a chance to look at it, but it's all guesswork and it's all conventional. You still have to pour a model. You still have to courier it out there. I always say this, like if the impression material is at minus 40 in Winnipeg and it's at a plus 115 in Dallas, you think that impression material might distort in both those cities at those temperatures?
Mm-hmm.
It might introduce errors. Well, if I send it digitally, boom, it's accurate.
Yeah.
Right?
Right.
There's
right.
no variability there, right? So now we do this and we take this digital impression. We take your photograph, we take your video, we send it digitally to the lab. The lab is looking at your photo. They're taking the intraoral scan and they're actually superimposing the 3D scan into your picture mm-hmm. and planning your design on your face on a computer screen.
Yeah.
Seeing how you move your lips. I can take a pose of you going like this. And they'll be able to plan it and go, hey, if Kirk's smiling like this, he wants to show this tooth more because you asked for it.
Right.
We can do that. Now I can take this 3D thing and stick it in the mouth. People are going, well, oh, it costs money. Well, all of that analog workflow costs you money anyway. There's no lab giving it to you free.
Right.
They're still going to charge you $400-$600 for that. And you're going to maybe charge $300 or $400 or $500 for the digital one. Well, what difference does it make? But I'm sending it instantaneously. And you, Kirk, as my patient, are involved in that design.
Yeah.
And you get a test drive.
Yep.
You get to test drive it and go, damn, this is good. Like, I like it. Or like, are you kidding me? I never want to walk around like this. My wife would not like this. Can you change it? Yeah, I can change it. Oh, I love the change you made. Now, can you give me exactly this? You're darn right I can, because I take a scan of that new one. And the lab will reproduce it to the exact copy.
Yeah.
Rather than looking at a model of it and going, okay, on a second model, I'm going to start designing the smile. And I think I'll get the wax in the right spot. It may not be perfect. Digitally, it will be exact because they'll take the copy of what you've approved, put it in the software, and it will be exactly the same shape and proportions that you requested.
Yeah, that's awesome. And Ricardo Matrani just said Paresh rocks, and I agree.
Hey, so I love Ricardo.
Ricardo's the best. You know, and the thing you're talking about too is it's bigger than the technology. It's the predictability has now greatly increased just in the last 5 years alone, because the more predictability you have as a great restorative dentist, the happier you are, I believe. The question I have for you though, you know, going to IDS or anything like that, you've got your hands around where the future of the digital practice is going. Where is it headed? I would love to know your thoughts.
I got to tell you something. And I didn't go to the IDS because I was really Ricardo at the Hinman meeting. And so, you know, and had a great time with him and his brother there and some of the spear guys. But one of my close friends, Ron Kaminer, he came back from the IDS. And on the Saturday night, he calls me and he says, "We got to talk." And I'm like, "Okay." And he calls me. He goes, "Dude, take our lectures and throw a big chunk of it out because the game's changed."
Why?
And I'm like, "Why?" And he said, "You know what? The stuff that's coming out in the next couple of years is just even light years ahead. And it's not all there, but it is coming." And so there, right now with digital, there are so many things that are going to be happening that it's going to be mind-boggling. For those people that are not into digital right now, you are behind. I'm already behind, and yet I'm ahead of the curve. Mm-hmm. Because we're getting to the point where we'll ultimately be able to do some of a lot of the things that I'm talking about really effectively. But picture that DSD that I was just talking about, where you're engaged in the smile, and we're superimposing the pictures on like your scans and designing everything on still photos, right?
Mm-hmm.
Picture right. it where we actually have you in 3D with your head sitting on the computer screen talking right now.
Right.
And you're talking and we're doing the design while in 3D in motion.
Mm-hmm.
And inside your CT scan superimposed, and inside you're talking to us and we're designing the smile as you talk to suit your bite. And doesn't that freak you out just a little bit though? And you know what? They were showing those parts of those things there as prototypes and the things that are coming out.
Wow.
And so you can't get into that if you don't have a scanner, mm-hmm. and if you don't have an iPhone or an Android, but that's all you need.
Wow.
That's all. And a great lab. Right. You don't have to do that all in-house. All that extra stuff in-house is bonus if you want to, but you need an intraoral scanner. You need a camera and or an iPhone and Android that takes good video and photos.
Okay.
And you need a great lab, lab that's experienced in digital workflow. You know, John Coyce talks about disruptive technologies. And when he uses that term, I believe it's a term in an endearing way, disruptive in a positive, forward-thinking way.
Right.
But if you have an inexperienced lab to work with and you're still not there at a certain level, then it's the blind leading the blind, in my opinion.
Right.
Okay? And so it can be disruptive in a negative way to the workflow of your practice. And when it gets disruptive to the workflow of your practice, your team doesn't like it.
Right.
They get stressed because they're going, "Paresh, like this is not good," because you know, all of a sudden the patient's sitting here, the case isn't ready, things aren't fitting, we're falling behind. Like, do we really have to do this?
Right.
And that's where the team doesn't like it. And a great lab with experience minimizes those disruptions and brings you to a higher level.
Right. Right. Yeah, absolutely. Now, this bears repeating because I do get this question and I want to just go right into it because of the trends with technology. This thing is, I mean, just think about what technology has done in dentistry just in the last 5 years.
Right.
And the argument is always this, you know, you're going to invest in technology and the maximum lifespan you're going to get out of purchased new technology is 7 years, maybe. And then it's going to change. So if I'm a young dentist, I'm just going to play the young dentist here who's 32 is like, because I think if you're watching this, you would agree. Like, I have to go digital. I have to. There's very few arguments that you'd say, "I don't think we should do that." I have to. Where should I start, Paresh? I mean, with the changes in technology, and I do want the contemporary digital practice, which you're going to strongly agree, the intraoral scanner, right? That would be the first investment.
Yep.
Second one, camera. And third one, great lab. Any other considerations you would say when it comes to embracing this work, the DSD workflow or digital workflow process?
If you don't train your team, you're dead in the water.
Right.
If you don't engage your team. And that is where it comes in. And I hear that one of the biggest challenges people have is they're trying to save some money. Right. And I get that. So we'll talk about finances in a sec because you brought that up. But they're trying to save money. So they're like, okay, well, I'm going to train. And some of them don't want to block off days.
Right.
You have battles with some of your
offices
where it's like, look, you got to block off a day, no patients.
Right.
And they're like, well, I'm losing production, so we'll do it in the evenings. And then the staff's not engaged. So you've got to allocate time, and you've got to allocate the resources. You're going to pay for it one way,
right,
of training the staff. If you don't have time and you're not a good trainer, then get out of the way, get the people that are, convey the message you want, and let them do their job.
Okay. Right.
Because if your team is not on board, that is the weakest link. Okay. Mm-hmm. Mine are unbelievable. I'm so proud of them. Mm-hmm. They make me a better dentist, period.
Amen.
Okay. My team right now, I got a tandem, and like my two dental assistants, for instance, they don't have necessarily the same personality types. They have some similarities. They work slightly different, but they work together to make me better. I guarantee you that if the two of them are not there together with me, I am not the same clinician right now. And it's the same with my hygienist. It's the same with my admin team. So that's what you need. Now, finances.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, you are going to be in right now in North America to get into a digital impression, like get into a digital scanner. You're going to be spending anywhere from $20,000 to $40,000.
Okay.
Okay. Depending on the features, bells and whistles, how they look, how they feel. I'm not trying to promote anything. I have clinical experience with six different scanners in my office. Clinical experience. I have three right now. I will be getting a fourth. Hey, don't follow my business practices, guys, because you don't make money that way. I want to do it, and I choose to do it. It's not a sound business decision, buying four different ones and all that, okay? Yeah. But what I'm trying to get at is you need to get into something. So start with one. Don't be scared. And what I say to do is, hey, pick it up, and pick it up with your team, with your key dental assistant, maybe a key hygienist, maybe all of them, and go, how do you like the feel of this when you're going to work with me on this? How do you like the software? How do you like the workflow when you're pushing buttons? Because some people will buy something because they're attached to a rep, or they're attached to just a company. And then they'll go, well, geez, I wish I had this or that. So look at what's important to you and how you're going to incorporate it. Because if you come in and get it, and then you want your team to roll with it and do some of the scanning and other things, and they're not going to like it because they're complaining about this and that, it's not going to happen. It's simply not going to happen.
Right.
So you've got to involve them in it. But you're going to spend between 20 and 40. Yes, the technology is going to change. But you know what? Right now, we're at a stage where it's different from 5-7 years ago, where you only could buy a CEREC or an E4D. You had to buy the whole system. You couldn't buy a scanner by itself and use your lab. Mm-hmm. Now the game's changed. You can start small and add and build to all of that. And ultimately, if you want to have an in-office system, you can partner and figure out ways to put it together. I've done that in my practice with different mills, different scanners, different printers. I've done it all. So right, I've worked through that workflow just for the fun of it. But right now, just get into it. Will some of it possibly be outdated in 5 or 7 years? Sure. But you know what? You're going to be in. I truly believe right now, it's not going to be outdated as fast, the hardware, as it is going to be the software, and it's easier to upgrade software.
Does that make
sense?
Yep.
Because now we're at the stage where a good chunk of them are color, they're faster, the scanners, in terms of acquisition. But the key part, the key component is the workflow in terms of talking to other softwares and labs are starting to open up more.
Mm-hmm.
So implant workflows, lab workflows. We're getting more and more the ability to just get a scanner and work with who you want to work with in a lab, which software you want to work with. It's just becoming more and more that way.
Yeah, this is awesome. And Greg Tice says, Paresh Shah lives this every day. Eric Rindler says, hola, gents. So,
hey, hello to those guys. I love them.
Absolutely. Les Rikas, great message, Paresh, and people love this. Now, a couple of things, other considerations. What are some other considerations you would say are big cornerstones or non-negotiables to the progress of a contemporary digital practice?
I use non-negotiable all the time with checklists.
We call them sacred cows, whatever you want to call them. There are things that you cannot negotiate. Yeah.
You can't, and that's one of them. So can I tell you one thing with training? I use TED Talks.
Do you really? With your team or with specialists?
With the team.
Okay.
Because they're quick, as you know. They're anywhere from 15 to 20 minutes, right?
Okay.
So recently, you know, I've had two newer team members over the last 9 months. And, you know, they're looking at me sometimes like rolling their eyes possibly about checklists. Like, are you serious? I've been, you know, I've got experience. I've worked at other practices or I've worked at other businesses and I could do this. So, and I think some people will look at it as a failure on their part that they can't do it on their own, right? You know what I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. And it's not a failure. It's about understanding that I can't do it all on my own because there's too many things. And I use that term about ingraining a pattern. Once you get something ingrained, it becomes second nature. It's easy to add on more and improve your skills.
Right.
The worst case scenario for me is I train someone so well that they're going to be more useful at another office.
Love it.
But they're going to grow their skills so much that I want them to stay in my office and become even better and more dynamic. Right. So I had a couple where I think that was the disconnect. So I said, okay, we're going to watch Atul Gawande's How We Heal Medicine. I put it on and I just said, and it was a spontaneous in our team meeting. I said, no, this is what we're doing.
I've seen it now. I love that. Tell them what it is.
Okay. So he talks about in his 20-minute TED talk, it's basically about checklists. And what he does is he talks about the pre-penicillin days where, you know, as a doctor, when you go into a hospital and you're trying to diagnose something, you know, you can pull out a book and you only have so many diagnoses for a condition and you've got only so many drugs you can use. And you might have 5 or 7 people that'll see you. You'll have your triage nurse, you'll have your nurse, you'll have your doctor and a lab tech, maybe a radiologist. Well, nowadays, I think they say you have about 11 to 15 different people you'll see in a hospital, the number of touches you have, and you have 5,000, 10,000 like drugs that you can use. There's no way we can remember all that. And it goes back to that toilet paper thing that I was talking about. Like, why should you come into an office and worry that my hand paper hasn't been filled from the night before because I had to rush off to take Johnny to basketball practice? Come in, look at the chat. Oh, yeah, I forgot to put my hand towels out in my operatory. Like, don't stress about it. It's not a failure. So he talks about that and how checklists can kind of transform construction in the medical industry. And it's not a failure. So, and he said, you know, it's changed the way I practice. It's changed the way surgeons practice. Mm-hmm. It's okay to, and he puts in little pause points in the checklist where if you don't pass this point without doing this, you can't go further. Right. Like marking the appropriate leg that you're going to do a knee replacement on, like fundamental stuff, introducing yourself. So what do we have on our checklist? Well, med history. If we haven't checked that off, we put those letters in red so we don't go to the injection until we've got the med history updated.
Right.
Little things like that, like deal breakers that will change the flow of their procedure. So the TED Talk showed that, and the two newer ones came and go, you know what? If these successful people can use checklists, I guess I can use it as well.
Right.
Changed overnight.
Well, okay?
That's been the big thing is the training part of it has been huge to bring everyone on board because you can't become that contemporary practice. You can't do the digital smile design. What did my assistant do? She took Christian's digital smile design template, created our own template with her photos and laminated it. Now it's in every one of our sheets. So when the patient comes in and they need the DSD photos, they've got their checklist and they just go, okay, here are the pictures. Here's the scan. Now we just fire it into the portal. It goes to Orem Labs. They do the design for me. It's done. We did two of them yesterday.
Yeah. And it's different because she did it. She created it. So she owns it more than a checklist. It's just handed to her. Correct.
Correct. Correct. Yeah.
Yeah. So, and I love the fact that you use TED Talks because sometimes your own team can't hear what you say. And right. It's so funny, like a third party introduces the same thought and you're like, I've been saying this for years, but it also works. And the other thing I want to just say about that particular talk, and I think John Coy said it too, the use of checklists in this process that you've described, Paresh, it's so critically important because you think about, you talked about pilots in airplanes. There's over 5,000 commercial airlines in the air at one time over North America. Can you imagine if we had a 1% failure rate? Like how many plane crashes would we have in a day? I think John Coy said that, but we'd have, I mean, you'd be basically looking at your newsfeed and you go, wow, another crash. Wow. There was another crash. There was another crash. So they can't afford even they have to have a 0% failure rate. Correct. And so the consistency factor that you're talking about in contemporary digital practice is crazy important. And I love the framework that you've laid out here, buddy. This is awesome. Now, I have so many more questions. Like, this could be a 3-hour show. And I want to do several of these with you. Yep. Let's do this. If people, which I know people are already going to have questions, if people want to ask you questions, how can I get a hold of you, Paresh?
You know, my email, which I didn't give Ben, but it's Shahp, S-H-A-H-P, at mymts.net, mymts.net.
Awesome.
And that's then, my email. And then my website, drpareshshah.com.
Okay, because we'll put that link up there too. Yeah. And then also too, if you want to see these guys in action, you got to come to Seattle Study Club Symposium. I mean,
absolutely. You know,
Vitriani, Rindler, I mean, all these guys are here. So it's great. It's a great place just to see it all. And it's overwhelming because you're like, that is so good. And you're,
that symposium is really something that I feel is all encompassing. I've got colleagues and I've learned a lot from John Coy. I've learned from all the like Mitrani and Frank Spear and Greg Kinzer and the guys from that teach down at the Spear Center as well. I mean, they're all phenomenal people. The interesting thing about the Seattle Study Club is it encompasses all of these people under one roof. So there's different philosophies. And it's cool because my mentors who have come from all of those things, including Ricardo, they're all there.
Yeah.
And I get to interact with them. I get to learn from them, get to share information with them. And, that was the one last piece, which we don't have to discuss that, but it's you're transforming to all of this, you need mentors.
Right.
And as a dentist, you need that. And you need mentors that are within your community. They could be business leaders as well on how to run the business properly. But you need clinical mentors. And that's where you end up going to places like Spear and Mish and Coyce. And of course, the Seattle Study Club is a no-brainer.
Yeah.
Because that's where you're getting it.
Yeah.
And join a study club. I'm biased, but I run my own Seattle Study Club with my buddy. And that's for another day. But the number one thing.
I'm biased too, and I think we would call that, both call that a non-negotiable.
the Seattle Study Club that we have is a non-negotiable. Absolutely.
Well, I'm crazy grateful. Stay on for a second because I want to talk to you for a little bit. But if you're watching this, thank you so much for watching. I hope you got a ton of value out of this. Now, again, if you're watching this after the live broadcast, please add your questions to the feed. And Paresh is awesome. He'll be able to get back to you and answer those questions specifically, even a little good debate. I like a great little debate when it comes to this stuff, because from that, you can come up with your own conclusions. So thank you, Paresh. Really appreciate you, brother.
Thanks, Kirk. It was a lot of fun.
You got it. You guys have a great day. Until we see you next time, keep watching the Best Practices Show.